studies now comes out to ACDF and undisclosed. So the inflammatory cascade plays a significant role in both acute and chronic spinal diseases. Recently, there's been a lot of research focusing on the relationship between inflammatory mediators and patient outcomes after orthopedic surgery. When we're talking about cervical spondylosis, we know that intervertebral discs release cytokines at elevated levels, and more importantly, these cytokines have been shown to affect patient outcomes when we're talking about myelopathy severity or even functional outcomes after spinal fusion. So in this diagram, when you have insults or injuries to the discogenic cell, there's this inflammatory cascade that happens, or this milieu of inflammatory mediators that ultimately generate pain. And the thought is that this can affect outcomes for patients, whether or not they undergo surgery. When we look at cervical spondylosis, the relationship between patient serum cytokine levels and symptomatic disease severity or outcomes after surgery are unknown. So the purpose of this study was to evaluate the relationship between inflammatory mediators and preoperative disease severity, as well as functional improvement after patients undergoing ACDF. So we performed a prospective cohort study over 2 years, looking at patients who underwent ACDF for radiculopathy and or myelopathy. We excluded patients who had autoimmune or systemic inflammatory diseases as their baseline serum pro-inflammatory cytokines may be abnormal. We had patients obtain a blood draw preoperatively in the folding area, and from their serum, we determined the concentrations of serum pro-inflammatory cytokines IL-6, IL-8, IL-1 beta, TNF-alpha, HMGB1, as well as the white blood cell count. We also tracked the patient-reported outcomes preoperatively and then minimum 1 year postoperatively. We looked at NDI, PCS, NCF-12, VESRM, and VSNF. We had a total of 77 patients that we prospectively enrolled. We had a follow-up here on variable 48 patients, 62% of patients at a minimum of 1 year, and the mean follow-up was 23 months. When we look at our demographics, the average age of our cohort was approximately 52 years. Of age, 60% of them being female. In terms of diagnosis, 53% were radiculopathy, 30% myeloradiculopathy, and 17% myelopathy. Two-thirds of these patients underwent multi-level fusion, and it was near 50-50 split in terms of duration of symptoms, with patients having less than 1 year of symptoms or greater or equal to 1 year of symptoms. When we look at the results, this plot demonstrates the concentration of the pro-inflammatory cytokines in the serum. Important to know that IL-1 beta was below the detection limit of our assay for nearly all the patients that we collected serum from, and there was a weak correlation between IL-6 and TNF-alpha. When you look at the correlation preoperatively of demographic age, sex, race, preoperative diagnosis, smoking status, the number of levels that we used, the duration of symptoms, and preoperative opioid use to our serum concentrations, we didn't find any meaningful correlations in the data. Similarly, when we looked at our preoperative PROMs, so NDI, VSRM, and NEF, and CPS, and MCS, again, we didn't find any moderate or strong correlations within the data. And then when we talk about how patients fared after surgery, we calculated a delta score, a recovery ratio, and an MCID for each of our PROMs, and again, we found no moderate or strong correlations within the data for patients with cytokines. So what can we say from this? There was no significant correlation between patient demographics and serum cytokines, no correlation between symptom duration, and no correlation between preoperative PROMs or improvement in PROMs after surgery. So the profiling of patient cytokines really has limited utility in predicting disease severity or outcomes following ACDF.